and welcome to another essential lecture in Jewish history. Today we're going to look at Jews in the medieval economy. To start with, much of our thinking about Jews in the economy is colored, unfortunately, by the image of Shylock. This is a character devised by William Shakespeare of a medieval Jewish moneylender in Venice. The title of the play is The Merchant of Venice. And Shylock is angered by the fact that his daughter has decided to marry a non-Jew. And in the context of the play, what Shylock does is he proposes the extremely harsh punishment to his debtor of exacting a pound of flesh for a loan that he failed to repay. The story ends up well for everyone, except for Shylock, of course, but the idea of Shakespeare's play really resonated very deeply in the Western imagination and kind of codified an image of the Jew as this avaricious, greedy, unscrupulous individual who was deeply involved with his money and will, you know, stop at nothing to get at it. So to a certain degree, this is a grossly unfair and highly anti-Semitic portrayal of Jews. Although I will highly recommend Shakespeare's play, I think that it's not at all a monochromatic or monodimensional representation of Jews. Even the money-lending Jew Shylock comes off quite sympathetic in certain passages. But let's try and understand what are the roots of this anti-Semitic image, and understand the role that the Jews played in the economy and how that affected their relationship with people around them. This is primarily true, by the way, we're speaking today about Jews in the medieval Christian economy. Within the Muslim world, things are slightly different. We're not going to treat that today. Okay, so first of all, in order to appreciate any sense of the Jews in the medieval economy, one must understand that Jews are a deeply and fundamentally urban people. Not since the Jews left the land of Israel in the first century, in the Roman exile, and until really their return in the late 19th century with the advent of the Zionist movement, have Jews been agrarian to any significant degree. For example, here is a Yiddish, looks like a film script, but shows the Jewish farmer, and I think it actually means the Jewish farmer. I mean, this is him. His name is Shloimeh. That guy behind him there isn't even a farmer. He's just helping him out. The idea is that there are so few Jewish farmers everywhere, anywhere. Even Tevye, the rural dweller of the shtetl in Fiddler on the Roof, was a dairyman himself. He wasn't even a worker of the land per se. And this is basically a truism for much of Jewish history, for reasons that I hope to explore in the next 15 minutes or so. But Jews basically avoided the agrarian experience after having left their homeland in Israel in the first century. They congregated in urban areas, either small urban areas like villages or increasingly in large cities. And this has a tremendous impact on what kind of professions Jews would choose and what kind of economic impact they would have in society. Here's a picture of typically Jewish urban environment, and Jews are a very gregarious people. They have to live within walking distance of a synagogue to form a minyan, a mikveh for the family purity laws, within distance of a Chinese restaurant for sure. I haven't had lunch yet. So these are the kinds of things that really make Jews want to live in an urban environment. And don't forget, it's also quite a bit safer for Jews to live in an urban environment, to live closer together, in many cases behind ghetto walls that were actually preferred and selected by the Jews themselves in many cases, because this did not so much prevent the Jews from leaving the ghetto as it prevented from marauders from getting into the ghetto. If you find this a very difficult concept to grasp, all you have to do is come down here to South Florida and drive around Boca Raton, and you'll see all these massive installations of Jews in things called gated communities, which are essentially, you know, modern self-imposed ghettos, because they're kind of keeping hoi polloi out and protecting the civilization within. So Jews are a fundamentally very urban population. Ironically, this means that they come into close contact with another highly urbanized element of the medieval population, and that is the clergy. you know, Jews, because they were increasingly living in larger towns and in cities, this is where the cathedrals were built. These were where peasants would gather for their church services. And so Jews and Catholic clergy were regularly brushing elbows in the urban environment, which had an unusual kind of spin-off effect in their relationship. And we'll talk about that more in the next lecture. But that's the first point. Jews are highly urbanized. Take away the ancient period when Jews lived in their land, take away the modern Israeli period where they live in their land once again, and in the 2,000 years in between, they're really a very urbanized people. Now, in that urban environment, it's important to realize that medieval society was structured quite differently from modern society. In modern society, you know, we are citizens, and the government deals with us as individuals. We all have a label called a social security for number, for example, in the States, or social insurance number in Canada. And the government wants to know exactly our individual taxes, and we have to pay on an individual basis to the society. And we're judged individually and, you know, tried individually and so on and so forth. This is not at all the case in the much more primitive medieval environment, in which people were grouped within communities, or more properly, corporations. This is sometimes called the feudal nature of society, in which people basically kind of like were coalesced, forcibly so often, within certain segments of society that correspond loosely to economic activities. If we look a little bit closer at this very simple drawing that shows serfs and peasants, the largest group of the population who are occupying the bottom of this triangle. Above them are knights and vassals who are engaged in, you know, various military affairs and things, so on and so forth. Above them you have the nobles and the church. And then finally you have the very top, the king. This is a fairly simplistic drawing, but this is the basic idea of feudal society. Now the question that remains is, where do Jews fit within this? They're certainly not the king. They're not the church. Are they nobles? Hardly. They're certainly not knights either. And are they serfs? No, they're not agrarian. They're living in an urban environment. So what exactly are they? So early on in the medieval period, Jews took on this status known as servi camerae, which is Latin for serfs or servants of the chamber, meaning the royal chamber. And this was a really important thing that had a tremendous impact on protecting the Jews and allowing them to survive much of the medieval period. Specifically, it has to do with the Abramson rule of history, which is money. It's really all about money. See, now, in all of those other groups, for the most part, were not generating cash income. Money, as we understand it today, in terms of currency, which, of course, back then was precious coins and metals, was not in large supply. People were dealing with a lot of barter, a lot of service exchange, things like that. And so you didn't have a lot of cash in society. But the Jews were going to be very prominently figured in commercial activities. And the Jews were the ones who were actually accumulating money, as we understand it today, in terms of cash. So the king realized this, and he took advantage of it by taking the Jews directly under his own economic supervision and taxing them directly without any intervening reporting relationships. For example, the knights did not tax the Jews, the church did not tax the Jews, only the king taxed the Jews. And this meant that there was a symbiotic relationship where the king had a vested interest in the economic well-being and the physical survival of the Jews in his kingdom. Because the more they survived, the more they flourished, the more tax income he could derive from them. This often put the king at odds with the clergy, and there was a secular and religious conflict over, you know, what role the Jews played in society. But this fact that they were servi camerae was extremely influential in protecting the Jews throughout most of the medieval world. Now, in that regard, how were Jews making money? The most important single piece of legislation that affected Jewish activity was the so-called Law of Gratian. Gratian was a church official from the 12th century who codified a practice into official canon law that allowed Jews to act as petty moneylenders. More important, not only were they allowed to act as moneylenders, they had a guaranteed monopoly on charging money on interest. Specifically, it's based on this idea that Jews and Christians, and actually Muslims to a different degree, have in common that it is forbidden to lend or borrow on interest from one's fellow. The verse in Deuteronomy says that, you know, you may charge interest to a stranger, you may not charge interest to your fellow. Which means, as the Jews interpret it, Jews may not borrow money and pay interest on it from another Jew. Jews may not pay interest to another Jew at all. And the I've tried calling up the various credit cards that I have in my wallet to see if the CEO is Jewish, but I haven't had too much success with that. At any rate, Christians, under Gratian in particular, interpreted this verse exactly the same way. To your brother, you must lend money without charging interest. To a stranger, you may charge interest. And so therefore, what that meant was that Christians couldn't borrow money from each other and pay interest, but they could borrow money from a Jew. And let's understand how important money lending is in a society. That's the only way that you are going to get any kind of commerce happening. That's the only way you're going to have any kind of like advancement to the economy. Let's say, for example, it's an agrarian economy and people are farming and they invest in their seed. They put their seed in the ground and then they've got to wait. They've got to wait until they can harvest it. And since the harvest is going to be months down the road, therefore they have to get some way to get through this difficult period. They borrow money at interest and then they'll pay it back at harvest time. So the Jewish activity as money lenders was extremely important for preserving and advancing the medieval economy. Here's an interesting image showing a Jewish medieval moneylender. You see him on the right there. He's wearing, so obviously this is designed by a Christian artist because you can see at the very bottom of his robe, he's got some Hebrew letters there, or that's actually pseudo-Hebrew because the artist doesn't know how to make it in this woodcut. And on the left is a Christian moneylender, a borrower. You can see that he's clean shaven. That's one of the marks of Christians in this period. And his money bag, which is on his belt, is empty. You can see kind of like the artist's rendition of empty pockets there. And he doesn't have any pants. I mean, come on. He can't even afford a pair of pants. No, I'm just joking. He's wearing hose. But anyway, he's got his hand out saying, I need money. And the Jew is sitting there with a big bag of money, and he's counting it out and so on. And he even has on his desk a primitive calculator known as an abacus to help him calculate the rates of interest and so on. Now, why would Jews want to go into money lending? Because one would think, you know, it's not such a nice profession, maybe. Why would you want to go into this? So here's the advantages. It's pretty clear. First of all, it's profitable. You can make a lot of money from money lending. We should understand that the interest rates that were charged in the medieval period could approach 50% interest. That's huge. That's more like the department store credit cards. Huge amount of interest. And very commonly, 30% interest rate. Secondly, as we mentioned before, it is urban. It allows Jews to remain in their traditional living quarters among other Jews and so on, assembling minyanim and things like that. Thirdly, it's intellectual labor, and perhaps another way to put that is not physical labor. Imagine the life of a farmer digging in the ground from dusk till dawn and, you know, backbreaking labor and, you know, any weather and all kinds of stuff like that. This is much easier work. You work with your brain instead of your back, so definitely much more attractive. It's portable because from time to time, Jews would be exiled, expelled from their homeland, from their place of residence. We'll talk about why that is in a moment. And so, when you have money, it's very easy to carry it from one place to another. You can bury it, come back and get it. It's not like real estate where, you know, it's stuck. And if you're exiled, that's it. You've lost it. So it's a very significant form of portable wealth. And finally, this kind of job, it's very easy. You can almost keep banker's hours, you know, let's say 10 till 3. And the rest of the time you have for Talmudic study and things like that. So money lending definitely has a lot of advantages. The disadvantages, though, are also significant. First of all, there's always the risk of non-payment. Now, it's true that when you have recalcitrant customers who will not pay you back, because the Jews were servi camerae, they could call on the king to enforce the arrangements and coerce recalcitrant debtors to pay. But that's a very difficult thing to do. You know, you've got to involve a lot, you've got to pull a lot of weight to do that. Secondly, you are even though this is an essential function in society, it's bound to promote some popular resentment. For example, credit cards. Everybody loves credit cards. When you get an application in the mail, it feels like free money, right? You don't have to do anything about it. But when you start getting those bills, and the bills just don't go away every time you make those minimum payments, you know, you feel a little bit differently about it. So there's going to be a certain amount of popular resentment building up against the Jews. When you get to the lecture on the Eastern European Center, you'll see how that really could result in sometimes catastrophic violence. In some occasions, this meant there were popular uprising, of which there were several, for example, in the 17th century, that devastated Jewish communities. And sometimes you would have a situation like in the 13th century where the Jews would be lending money to powerful lords. And when the debt got simply too high, the lord said, you know what, it's better to cut our losses. Let's just kick the Jews out. It'd be easier to just wipe our debts clean, not have any more Jews. Then, as for example, what happened in France in the 13th century, the Jews were actually expelled three times, which meant that, you know, they were invited back four times, because what would happen is they would be expelled because the debt load would get too high, and then people say, you know what, we really need that credit function again. They bring the Jews back, start money lending again, and then they say, you know what, this debt is low, get them out of then, and so on. It's like a friend of mine that dovens at my shul who was kicked out of yeshiva three times, and I said to him, yeah, but that means you were accepted twice at least. Okay, aside. Anyways, so that's the money lending was certainly the backbone. It was the primary, pillar of the Jewish economy for much of the medieval period and many of the countries in which they lived. But that was by no means the only way that Jews, you know, supported themselves in this economy. For example, Jews were highly active in a whole range of trades. Remember, if the vast majority of the population, we're talking about over 90, 95% of the population is farmers, they generally don't have a lot of time or leisure to develop specialized crafts. And so as a result, these urbanized Jews began to, you know, socially stratify their activities into highly specialized activities like the needle trades, in which Jews excelled later on in history. Also silversmithy, making gold objects, anything from simple spoons and knives and things like that. And you can tell, by the way, by the kind of surnames that Jews often have, like Schneider, which means tailor, or Zilber, with silver for silversmith, you know, all kinds of things like that. They're also involved in music and the arts. This, by the way, is... in the center there in the white jacket is my good friend Aaron Kula, who leads an amazing modern klezmer troupe called the Klezmer Company Orchestra. I'll try and play some music of his under the background when I edit this video. And because Jews have the potential to get together and rehearse, unlike, you know, peasants who are living far and spread apart in their farms and things like that, it meant that Jews were able to develop in the arts quite significantly, and many of these medieval musicians were in fact Jewish, certainly in 19th century Eastern Europe. And another interesting aspect of Jewish activity was tavern keeping, as you can see in this depiction showing Jewish tavern keepers and a klezmer musician there with, looks like, Polish, perhaps Ukrainian clientele. Jews could set up these way stations for peasants to either come in and get a drink or for travelers to actually enjoy a hotel meal. It's also related to the distribution and production of alcohol, which Jews often had a monopoly on, especially in Eastern Europe, something called Provenatia, and this is also a profession that continued over into the modern era. Finally, we should understand that many Jews were, again, we're talking about Jews who are urbanized, literate, which made them highly distinct from the rest of the population, and so they were able to engage in real professions as well, such as, for example, medicine. Jews certainly were involved in medicine from the very early medieval period, and excelled in that field. Maimonides is a great example, and continues it once through to the modern period as well. So that's just an overview of many of the types of occupations that Jews were engaged in. They all really hinge on the fact that Jews were urbanized. And I think that sense of their dwelling arrangements has a lot of, that it's really a key idea to understand much of what happens in medieval Jewish history. Okay, thank you very much for watching.